So after designing the Axis in Fusion 360, I used a very innovative and professional method in order to make the Axis straight. Then I installed the Axis, the 3D printed Axis, into the windmill, which required a bit of force, as you can see. Finally, the Axis fitted inside the windmill, shoved all the way in, and I was taking care of the wiring in order to fully test the Axis to later mount on the hub that the wings will attach to. So after a refit, I gave the motor a quick spin to feel what the flexibility of the 3D printed Axis was like. The rotational forces obviously gave it a bit of wobble, and you could really feel the flexibility inside the Axis, and I wasn't sure if that was a good thing. But nevertheless, I picked the wing hub, mounted it to the Axis to check if the holes that I had created aligned. As you can see on the right side of the Axis, the center hub that I 3D printed in order to clamp the Axis down didn't fully fit over the Axis, so I had a quick sanding to do there, or use some force. And here I'm zooming in to show you that the holes did align. You can see the black hole in the middle, yeah, over there. So my measurements were accurate, and everything fitted. So after creating a schematic in KiCad, I gathered all the required resistors and diodes in order to form and solder the circuitry. The resistors are used to dump power into when the speed of the windmill gets too high, and the diodes will form the rectifier that rectify the three-phase AC signal incoming. Here you can see me test fitting the Arduino Nano, which will be the brains of the windmill controller. I'm fitting it inside the main hub to see if there's any room for headers, which I'll usually use because electronics burn and break and stop working, and when you solder directly to the prototyping board, you have to desolder everything, and that's just a huge pain. So after putting the headers on to the Arduino Nano, I'll insert it into the PCB, make the first solder connection, and after that I'll remove the Arduino to prevent excessive heat from getting into it. After coming to the conclusion that the through holes were too small for the legs of the diodes, I used a drill to drill out the holes in order to make the diodes fit. I used a nice press drill for this, and it was relatively easy to do. After test fitting the diodes, it was finally time to solder them onto the PCB in order to get the rectifier wired up, which you can see me doing over here. I insert all the diodes in the enlarged through holes that I used the drill press for, and they all fit well perfectly. The diodes, the length of the diodes stacked up in front and in the back of each other was just too long, so I needed to do a little side trick, and which turned out really well actually, in order to make the diodes fit onto the PCB. After soldering all the diodes to the PCB, it was time to solder the connector to the PCB, and that will feed the actual three-phase power into the controlling circuitry. I used a regular battery connector for that. I think it is, no, it's a regular BLDC connector, the yellow thing with the three leads, very high current, and it allows for easy connect and disconnect of the generator, which is always a nice thing. So the phases, the order of the phases, don't really matter, because it's basically just the electricity that comes from the rectifier or the BLDC directly fed into the rectifier. So there's no switching of the phases in there. if you're doing a more advanced regulation of the three-phase AC signal, I recommend labeling the phases and also creating some kind of feedback circuitry that will feed the voltage reading into the Arduino, so you can read out the voltage and act based upon the voltage. After soldering some wires to the rectified ends of the three-phase rectifier, I attached it to my multimeter in order to check the voltage, to see if the thing is working when I rotate it. And as you can see, the voltage bumps up as I rotate the motor. Now the hub gave a lot of friction, so that's why the motor instantly stopped rotating. So in the final build, that will be fixed, of course, since that's just a waste of energy. It will also wear out, because yeah, it's still plastic, and if plastic moves a lot over each other, then it will wear out and finally decreasing the resistance. Now I connected the output of the rectifier onto the current sensor to check if that makes any difference, and that did not make any difference. It's also connected to the capacitor bank, I believe, and you could see the capacitor bank discharge for a brief moment. So voltage is being generated with the PLDC. So after covering up the garden stones with a cardboard shield, which was not completely shielded, so I recommend you find something else for that, since there are some white marks on the stones right now. I sent everything down, used a bit of primer to get the first two layers to stick properly. Then I used UV resistance and weather resistant white spray paint. One of the bottles, the last one actually, was malfunctioning, and the paint didn't come out of it. There wasn't enough pressure. So I held it in warm water for a bit, and that kind of worked. So yeah, but it was a bit of a challenge, since there was not enough paint, or basically no paint, coming out of the nozzle. I also recommend that you wear another glasses, so glasses that you don't really care about, since my glasses were completely white spotted with paint, because I was going with the wind and against the wind. Yeah, that it was also, as you can see, it was a bit too windy actually to paint. And you can see me grabbing everything, removing the leaves. So after editing my existing 5mm to 8mm adapter with a slot that's used to hold the actual axis instead of the screw going through the axis, I used hearing protection, of course, and an angle grinder to grind the slot onto the axis itself. I used a press drill, and I was not able to go through the axis at all. Yeah, the steel was way too hard, and you can see that the angle grinder has got some difficulties with it as well. You can see that by the amount of metal that's being removed with such a long grind. Sparks were flying literally everywhere, and yeah, I felt like a real man when using the angle grinder. But I needed to grind off a lot more until the tape, the white tape or yellow tape that you can see just outside of the vice grips. And yeah, it also needed to be straight, because it needed to be to slide right into the actual axis adapter that I 3D printed, and it's almost fitted. I think if I heat up the axis, that it will just slide through the 3D printed plastic and make its way through. Now, after a lot of little grinds, the axis finally became relatively straight, and I continued to redesign a new windmill controller, since all the previous windmill controllers, yeah, basically blew up and didn't work or partially worked. So after I finished the schematic and made sure that all the parts are there, I started creating the PCB. Initially, I went off with a DIP package of the Atmega 328P, but I came to the conclusion that that was simply too big. You can see me trace the ACS712 chip here. That's the current sensor. I made sure that the in and out pads have sufficient copper attached to them. So I made a copper zone that attaches to the in and out going pins. Now you can see me creating PCB cuts in order to make sure that the voltage doesn't spark, because the break is really essential and we don't want that to fail. On the right you can see the diodes over here, and you can see the connection blocks. Now I'm placing all the connectors to the PCB. I'm doubting if I should keep the big capacitors, because they don't really add up to anything. So now the final PCB looks like this. It's a little more complicated than I initially thought it would be. That's because the big through-hole resistors didn't fit at all. I also added two buck boost conversion style power supplies to provide the system with a 5 volt and a 3.7 volt that's used for charging the battery voltage supply, but the main thing is still the same. So if I disable the rat's nest, yeah, it doesn't make much of a viewability difference. Let's go to the 3D view. Of course, that's on my other screen. Now, the terminal blocks are not the blocks that I'll be using, so don't worry about parts clipping and all those other things. Let's go over a quick tour of the of the PCB. This is the 5 volt thing, I believe. Let's check. Is it through? No, yeah, that's the 5 volt. 5 volt power supply with all the capacitors, diodes, and all the required resistors and inductors. Then over here you've got the 3.7 volt regulation system. It takes the voltage of the BLDC as an input, so that's probably around 3 till 40 volts, so I think that that should be enough. Inductor to support it, and over here you've got the MOSFETs. For the quick glance, I think they're both for the 5 and the 3.3 volt. Yeah, that's the 5, this one. And at the bottom, I think this one is for the 3.3 volt output. Oh no, this is both for 5. Yeah, the 5 consists of two MOSFETs. And I think I placed them rather smartly at the top and at the bottom. They were on top of each other, but then I had space issues, so I put them aside. But nevertheless, I think this is quite an efficient design like this. It looks maybe a bit crude, but hey, it's not for crudity, it's for ease of use and ease of soldering and fit issues. Yeah, that's it basically. Here you can see the current sensor with a nice slot in between the in and out and in between the chip. I've also added diode cutouts just to make sure that you know, positive stays positive and doesn't spark over or spark back, that the voltage actually goes through the diode. Power resistors, and yeah, these are the MOSFETs that switch the charging of the capacitor, which maybe were removed. I think that that one's this MOSFET, and this one is the one that switches the energy dump on and off, basically in case of an emergency. And if we move to the bottom, yeah, we can see an LR MOSFET for the 5 volt regulation system. Now here's our Atmega 3D8P. I switched to this package because, yeah, space issues. As you can see, the board is pretty pretty crowded and pretty well populated. The routing took quite some time. It took a really long time to properly route it and to get, well, I've got one DRC error, let's be honest. But that's this one. You know, the landmark, I think it's called. You've got the footprint and you've got the footprint surrounding area. And this one is inside the footprint of the Atmega 3D8P. But that doesn't matter as there's nothing here. And the footmark goes in a square and doesn't really follow the pins. So we won't got any problem. And I picked I think this is called a resonator. It contains the required capacitors to smoothen out the signal. And that's built in. So that's why it has a third lead which connects to ground. There are a few through-hole resistors here and there. That's because I've got them on stock. And yeah, if they fit, then why not use them? Now, I've got a few questions or things I'd like to discuss with you. One of them is, let me open the schematics. All right, one of them, the charging of the battery. As you can see, this is the 3.7, 5 to 40 volt to 3.7 at 9 amps max, so quite a beefy power supply. So this is the 3.7 volt regulator schematic, and here you can see the battery. And the thing I'm questioning is, at total blackout, so no power in the battery, no power in the capacitors, the board is completely empty, no electricity at all, the BLDC starts spinning and generates electricity. Now, the Arduino is being powered from the battery by using the 5 volt buck boost converter. But in order for that to work, there has to be a battery charge. So this chip needs to be enabled. And I want to toggle the enable and disable pin of this chip in order to see whether I can create some kind of MPPT system. And to do that, I created a pull up to Vin. So that's the output, the current measured output of the BLDC. But that would result in a 15 volt-ish voltage going over this line. And therefore, I attached a diode that clamps down the voltage. Now, what I want is to disable and enable the chip. High or low signal is required. But I want to provide those signals using the Atmega 328P. So I put in a diode in front of the signal to clamp it down, hopefully. But now my question is, will this work? So if you've got any ideas on my question or any solutions on how to control this, please let me know in the comments down below. And I think I'll wait for your answers before I order this PCB, because if this fails, my Omega 328P will blow up because there's 15 volts on the chips, and that's not what we want. I was also thinking about using a transistor to do this, but then again, the signal needs to be on when there is any kind of voltage in the system, so the Arduino doesn't have a power to turn it on. Maybe I can do something with a capacitor that's being charged when the BLDC gets power or something. I'm not sure, but I can tie this to VIN, then I won't be able to control it. Or I can do it in this way, and then I will be able to control it, I think. So I'm thinking of using a transistor maybe, but I'm not sure how to properly implement this. So if you've got any ideas, please let me know. I will also open the 5-volt regulator just for completeness of this video. If you want to open this design, here's the Webench link that I used for this power supply. Webench is very easy. You provide the input and the output parameters, and it will generate a schematic for you that complies to those parameters. So let me open the 5-volt regulator. Yeah, the 5-volt regulator is way smaller, and I think that has something to do with the current draw of the 3.7 volt. The 18650 charge protection board is rated for 9 amps. Now, it's an AliExpress board, so I expect only half of the current to be ever going to flow to the battery, but nevertheless I created it for 9 amps. And this is a 5-volt buck boost converter. On both the chips, I have got a power good pin that I'll be using to monitor the chip's state if the power is good. The original complete schematic. Yeah, this is the terminal block that the BLDC connects to, the rectifiers. As you can see over here, there's the braking system with the MOSFET. It's a pull down, so the MOSFET is always off, except for when I provide a positive voltage to the brake low netlist over here. Yeah, it goes through the thing and provides an analog voltage relative to the current going through the chip. Required capacitors, voltage references, programming pins, program header. There's a programming header on the board as well, which is really useful since I don't have any other board that contains a flat package 328P. Over here, it looks kind of funny, but these are two connectors. One is the JSP connector. You can see it on the 3D view over here. That's this one, but I'm not sure if I'll be using that to connect the Hall effect sensors inside the BLDC. So I've also added a regular 2.54mm header. I need to connect it differently. There's a temperature sensor on the board. Yeah, it's for fun and for scientific purposes. I want to measure how hot it gets inside the window. And there's a 433 megahertz transmitter that I'll be using to read out the data from. So the windmill will send a telegram containing max voltage, max current, average current, all that stuff to monitor how much power this thing generates. So yeah. Have I missed anything? I don't think so. No, I don't think so. So that's my question. Have I implemented the enable pin of the 3.7 volt chip properly? If I didn't, please let me know how I would implement it. And if I did, yeah, please also let me know. So yeah, thanks for watching this video. I'm hoping to come back to you with a update very quickly. But I'm not sure how and when, because of the COVID-19 issue we're currently having. I'm not sure how that impacts ordering the PCB and all that stuff. So, yeah, you will hear from me. And, well, thanks for watching, and I hope to see you in my next video. Bye. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you did, please leave a like and make sure to leave a comment down below. You can also share this video with your friends if you think they will like it too. See you next time.